First, let me tell you, look at this picture. It's a cross section of the spinal cord. Can you tell me from which segments this has been taken? Is it cervical or thoracic or lumbosacral? And why? This section is taken from which part of the spinal cord? Is it taken from the cervical or thoracic or lumbosacral? Thoracic, right answer, but why? Look at the only the spinal cord, don't look at anything else. Look at this only the spinal cord section and tell me what is the special things about it with which you can tell that it is from thoracic section. What is special? Is it same as the cervical area also? Cervical area section looks same? No. What is the specialty? What is the special things about the thoracic? Lateral horn is not there in the cervical area. Why not? Because that is the starting point of sympathetic fibers. So sympathetic fiber starts from gray matter. Which gray? Lateral thing. Lateral horn. Okay? So sympathetic fibers first, again, another very basic question. Sympathetic fiber sends signal in which way? From periphery to center or center to periphery? Sympathetic fiber sends signal in which direction? Again, it's very important that all pain physicians should be having a very clear idea about the sympathetic nerves. Sympathetic nerves is so, so much important in managing pain. We are regularly doing so many sympathetic blocks, stellate block, celiac block, without knowing the anatomy of it, without knowing why we are doing it. So it must be very, very clear that, you know, what is its role in pain, and when we are doing some sympathetic block, how it might be helping our patients. Okay, so come back to my question, that sympathetic nerve sends signal in which direction? Center to periphery or periphery to center or both?
Both.
So it sends signal in either direction? Either direction? Same nerves is sending signal to the either direction? Can it? Can a nerve send signal in either direction? May I have another question? Can a nerve send a signal in either direction? Yes or no? Answer is both yes and no. Why both yes and no? Physiologically, signal transmission always in the one direction. That means afferent fibers will be sending signals from periphery to the center and efferent fibers from center to periphery. This is, we are talking about the physiological condition. But if we are applying electrodes, like what is done in the EMG and CV studies, in that situation what happens? Signal can go in either direction. That means when you are putting electrodes and applying external electricity, then these stimulations, action potentials, will be traveling on the either side. Antidromic transmission. That is possible only when you are external. Otherwise, physiologically, a nerve can send signal only in one direction. So what about sympathetic fibers? So there are both different sympathetic fibers as well as afferent sympathetic fibers. And that's why they can send signals on the other side. Earlier, the sympathetic fibers was called double-edged sword. Earlier, it was thought that sympathetic fibers are something special. They can send signal on either way. But later on, it was understood, no. Because they are very thin fibers, they are so compact together, it was looking like a one shape, one fiber, but actually they are two fibers. That means they have both afferent as well as efferent. So starting from the efferent fibers, so efferent fibers, they are starting from gray matter. Which gray? Lateral horn. So here they are starting. And then These are efferent fibers you are talking. So efferent fibers will be accompanying the other efferent fibers. That means other motor fibers. The other motor fibers is starting from which part of the spinal cord?
Anterior
or ventral horn. So they are coming ventral horn and then ventral root. Ventral root is motor. So these sympathetic efferent fibers also accompanies the motor fibers, ventral root, and then they come to join the dorsal to form the mixed spinal nerve. So how are they joined? Which part of the spine they are joining? At the level of foramen, neural foramen. There they are joined. And then they become a mixed spinal nerve and comes outside the neural foramen. After coming outside the neural foremen, you know that a nerve root is dividing into ventral rami and dorsal rami. Isn't it? Ventral rami is mostly motor and dorsal rami is mostly sensory. But we forget most of the time that before the ventral rami and the dorsal rami division, the first division where nerve root is coming outside the foramen is rami communicates. That is the first division. So immediately outside the neural foramen, when the nerve root is coming, the first one is your rami communicants. So this rami communicants fiber is efferent sympathetic fibers on the lateral horn, then ventral root, then the mixed spinal nerve at the level of the neural foramen, just outside the neural foramen, the white rami communicants. And then they join the sympathetic chain. What is the sympathetic chain? Sympathetic chain is from cervical one up to coccyx one. There are two sympathetic chains on either side, but at the level of the coccyx ones, they two unite to form the last ganglion, that is ganglion impulse. Okay? So this first order neuron are also called preganglionic efferent sympathetic fibers. Via the white rami they are coming, joining the sympathetic chain, and then they end there. They can end at the same segment, or they can ascend up, or they can descend down, such that they end at each spinal nerve root level. As we discussed, that the sympathetic fibers are thoracolumbar from T1 to L2. But as we discussed, that there are sympathetic fibers also in the cervical area, also in the sacral area. So how they are getting it? They are getting these fibers which is traveling up or traveling down. So the fibers, say for example T1 or T2 level, not necessarily ending at the T1 and T2. Some of the T1 fibers, some of the T2 fibers, some of the T3 fibers, they ascend up and then they end at each level. C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, C8, at each level. They don't have their own sympathetic fibers because sympathetic fibers starts from T1. So C6, C7, cervical level, how they are getting sympathetic fibers? They are getting from these fibers which is ascending up. Same way in the lumbosacral areas, the fibers which is coming from L1, L2, T2L, they travels down and they end at all lumbar sacral into the coccyx. So first order ends there. First order sympathetic efferent fibers are thinly myelinated, and that's why they look white, and that's why this is called white rami. All other sympathetic fibers, efferent second order fibers or afferent fibers are non-myelinated. So whole of the sympathetic nerves are non-myelinated except preganglionic efferent sympathetic fibers, they are thinly myelinated. So first order neuron ends at, where are they ending? They are ending along the sympathetic chain at each spinal nerve root level. And now the second order efferent sympathetic fibers are starting. Post-ganglionic sympathetic fibers. Are from the starting? From the sympathetic chain. and they come back
via the brain amygdalus
and join the nerve root at the almost at the same area where they left the nerve root.
So where this brain amygdalus fibers will be there?
They will be at all spinal nerve root level.
Where are the white amygdalus fibers?
They were only from T1 period. Because the white amygdalus fibers are the beginning sympathetic fibers starting from the lateral horn, coming via the white ramen, join the sympathetic chain. So they are only in thoracolumbar segment from T1 to L2. But gray amygdalus fibers are there, which is coming from sympathetic chain, not from the spinal cord, from the sympathetic chain. And sympathetic chain is distributed from cervical 1 to coccyx 1. So second order neuron coming from the sympathetic chain, they are joining with all spinal nerve root level. That means all spinal nerve root have sympathetic component coming from postganglionic fibers coming from sympathetic chain. So preganglionic fibers end at each level such that each nerve root is getting sympathetic component. So in other way you can tell that white primary communicant fibers are there only from T1 to L2, whereas the gray primary communicant fibers are there at each spinal nerve root layer. Is it clear? And then they go to the periphery and they have different sympathetic fibers. What are their functions? Two important kind of functions. One is pseudomotor fibers. Have you heard it? Not pseudo. Pseudo, S-U-D-O, pseudomotor. What are its function? Sweating. The smooth muscles around the hair follicles. So these are pseudomotor fibers. So when the sympathetic discharge is there, efferent sympathetic, then it can contract the hair follicle muscles. It can cause the sweating. These are pseudomotor fibers. We'll be discussing it later on in the CRPS. That there will be disturbance in the pseudomotor functions of these fibers. But efferent sympathetic fibers also have the other activities. They release the catecholamines, and those catecholamines also will be binding with the different other smooth muscles, like controlling the blood pressure. There are different other receptors, alpha, beta, beta 1, beta 2. So they will be binding with all this and they will be having. Most you have to remember, the efferent sympathetic fibers contract the smooth muscles and also control the different secretory functions. So they are the functions of efferent sympathetic fibers. So how they are going to the periphery? Via all the nerve root initiating, and later on they are also accompanying the blood vessels to go to the periphery. And sympathetic efferent fibers are distributed all over the world. There is no single small area where the sympathetic efferent fibers are not there. So it is distributed all over the body. How? By the spinal nerve root. By the gray amygdalus. So, in other way, you can also tell that the efferent sympathetic fibers are diverging. Initially, they are coming only from the few segments and then they are distributed, they are diverging and they are ending at the each and every part of the body. So, this is efferent, which is going to the periphery where the somatic nerves. But for the viscera, it is a little bit different. How is it different? For the viscera, these fibers, and after joining the sympathetic chain, the first order neuron are not ending there. They extend further, goes closer to the viscera. Like say, for example, when we are talking about the cilia ganglia. You must have heard of cilia ganglia? Already said it? But the celiac trunk is originating from the aorta at the level of lumbar one. So, from this ganglion, efferent sympathetic fibers innervates the upper abdominal viscera, like pancreas, like stomach, like hepatobiliary system. So, these areas, the sympathetic efferent fibers comes from celiac ganglion. So now, how the sympathetic fibers are coming to the celiac ganglion? So the first order neuron, preganglionic fibers, after joining the sympathetic chain, they are not ending here. Those which are going to the periphery, somatic fibers, they are ending there. But those which is coming to the viscera, either the thoracic viscera or the abdominal viscera, they are not ending there. They are joining the sympathetic chain and then again leaving the sympathetic chain without having any ganglion there. And then they are going closer to the viscera and they are having the ganglion at the close to the viscera, visceral ganglion. First order neuron ends there and second order neuron from there innervate the respective viscera. Some fiber still goes down, mesenteric ganglion, not ending at the ciliary ganglion, going to the ciliary ganglion, not ending there, and then ending at the mesenteric ganglion, and from there they are supplies to the different parts of the gut. Some goes to the aortocarinal, some goes to the hypogastric. In that way, they are innervating the referent viscerals. Right? So, what is the difference here? Here there is no cranial ganglion. Here there is no ganglion at the sympathetic chain. So, they join the sympathetic chain and they leave and they go first up to the viscera, having ganglion there, postganglionic fibers goes to supply the respective. What are its function? Again, secretory and smooth muscle contraction or relaxation. Like gut or urinary bladder, we'll be discussing it. What are the functions of the sympathetic fibers? Sympathetic fibers constrict the sphincters and relax the smooth muscles. Peristalsis will be reduced. The bladder relaxing the adducer muscles so that there will be retention of the urine. Sympathetic fibers is active. Or they are also having the secretory functions. Like we are having a lot of glands in our GI tract, so they will be secretory. Okay, so this is your visceral efferent sympathetic fibers. So sympathetic efferent fibers, they are broadly divided into two, one going to the viscera, they don't have any cranial components, and one which is going to the periphery. They are going via the granuli and then via the nerve root and then via the blood vessels to go to the all over the all the part of the body. Right? So this is efferent sympathetic fibers. No afferent. For the afferent, let us start with the viscera first. One thing you have to remember that the afferent sympathetic fibers is only one nerve. Efferent sympathetic fibers, there was two nerve, preganglionic, postganglionic. Here there is only one nerve. And what is the same body of that nerve? At the dorsal root ganglion, here, just like the somatic nerve. So, let us trace these fibers. Say, for example, for the pancreas. So, these afferent fibers from the pancreas going through the ciliary ganglion without having a ganglion. So, ganglion is for efferent fibers, not for the afferent fibers. So, they are going through the ciliary ganglion without any synapse there. Then they join the sympathetic chain again without any synapse there, and then they join the nerve root via the white rami communicators. Now it is in the opposite direction. Earlier it is in this direction, now it is in this direction. So they join the sympathetic chain and then via the white rami. At which level? Depending on where they are coming, but it must be between T1 to L2, because other than that, there is no other greater point of communications. But again, depending on which part of the body, like if you are discussing about the abdominal viscera, they will be entering only from T5 to T2L. So, from the ciliary ganglion, these fibers go into the sympathetic chain, and then from there, via the point of communications, they are joining the nerve root. What they are joining? Just outside the foramen. So the rami communicants fibers is just outside the foramen. And then instead of going to this path, they are going to the dorsal root. Dorsal root ganglion is the same body and they ends at dorsal horn. Then how the signal is transferred to the brain? Via which fibers? Same. Spinal thalamic tract. Like the somatic pain, the same nociceptive signal is also transferred by the spinal cord, starting from the dorsal root. Right? So this is for the visceral innervation, mostly the visceral innervation, visceral nociception is transmitted this way. But one very important aspect is The ciliary ganglion is not the ganglion for the afferent fibers. So if you are talking about ciliary ganglion block for the CA pancreas, is it a correct language? Is it a correct one? No. The ganglion is for the efferent fibers, not for the afferent fibers. So better terminology is ciliary plexus block. What is the difference between these two? Ganglion is for efferent fibers and plexus is for both efferent and afferent together. You cannot specifically burn out only the afferent fibers. You can't do it. Collateral damage will be there. Collateral damage is also you are destroying the ganglion as well. But the ganglion is not our primary target. Our target is afferent fibers which is traveling through the ciliary plexus. Right? So this is your sympathetic afferent fibers and coming from the visceral. And sympathetic afferent fibers which is coming from the periphery, how they will be coming? So again they will be coming higher. So what do you know? And after coming closer to the foramen, they will be separated there by the gradami communicants. So all sympathetic fibers, all the nerve roots, they are coming because each nerve root have the sympathetic fibers, both efferent as well as afferent. So we discussed about the efferent, well now we are discussing about the afferent. So these afferent fibers are accompanying nerve root and coming closer to the foramen, they are separated by the gradami communicants, join the sympathetic chain. So these gradami communicants are there at which level? Each spinal nerve. And then they converge. When we discussed about the efferent fibers, they are diverging. They are initially coming only from T1 to L2 and then they are diverging via all the different nerve roots. And when you are talking about the afferent, they are coming via the, all the nerve roots and now they are converging to enter into the spinal cord via T1 to L2 white trauma. So they are joining there and then they via the white trauma again the rest of the path is separate. So this is efferent center. Now, sympathetic fibers have certain things which is very special, you have to remember that. And many times we have been discussing that whether there is a sympathetic component of it, whether this pain is mediated by the sympathetic fibers, whether this pain is maintained by the sympathetic fibers. So you have to understand few other things. One very commonly described term when you are discussing about the sympathetic fibers is it is called the non-segmental. What is the meaning of it? What is called non-segmental? Simple example. If I am passing here and if I am asking you that tell me these touch fibers is traversing via which nerve root? Can you tell? At the base of the thumb. This touch signal is entering, reaching our brain via which nerve root? Base of the thumb? C6. So C6 nerve root is carrying this. But if I am asking you, tell me, the sweat glands here are innervated by sympathetic fibers coming from which segment? Can you tell me? You can't. Why? Why you can't? Because they are non-segmental. They are non-segmental. There is a lot of overlapping. Just now we have discussed that from T1 to T2 to T3, these fibers are ascending up. So normally, the somatic fibers for the hand is via the brachial plexus. Root value? C5 to T1, but fibers might be coming from C4 and T2 as well. But mostly C5 to T1 is for the somatic nerves coming into the upper limb. And you can, we know the zebra pictures, zebra pattern. This is your C6, up to here is C5, then middle part is C7, this is C8, this is T1. We know this pattern for the somatic nerves. But this pattern is not there for the sympathetic. So these sympathetic fibers are not coming from the cervical level. They are originating from thoracic levels. So again, this is a very common question. In different philosophy exams, this comes very commonly. Tell us, upper limb sympathetic fibers are coming from which spinal segments? And is it having a dermatomal pattern? Answer is no. It is non-dermatomal, non-segmental, coming from the thoracic areas. Because it is thoracolumbar only. So thoracic areas. Which thoracic areas? P2, 2, P8. Some books says P2, P6, some books says P2, 2, P8. That means the upper limb sympathetic fibers are coming from thoracic 2 to thoracic 8. They are ascending up, as I told, they are ascending up and they are ending at each spinal nerve root level. Then they accompany the brachial plexus fibers and comes in the hand. This is how they are coming. And it is non-dermatomal, non-segmental.
Now if you are asking this question, that where from the sympathetic fibers are coming and innervating the head and neck? T1 to T3. Where from the sympathetic fibers are coming to innervate the thoracic viscera? T1 to T5. Abdominal viscera? T5 to T12. And lower limb? T12 to less number of fibers. Like the lower limb, also we are having the less number of neurons for the lower limbs, whereas we are having the large number of neurons for the upper limbs. We will be discussing this later on. So, just now, we are discussing about what are the special features about the sympathetic nerves, which is making them different from the somatic nerves. One of them is, it is non-segmental, non-dermal. So, if sympathetic fibers are carrying pain, is there any difference? Is there any difference in the clinical features? By which you can tell, okay, this pain might be mediated by the sympathetic fibers? Yes. And here, I will be giving you a very classical example. Abdominal pain because of appendicitis. No, you just remember the third year MBBS studies. So, appendicitis is very common. So now tell me, at the initial phase of appendicitis, when the infection is within the lumen of the appendix, what the pain will affect? How will the character of the pain? At the initial part, when the infection is within the lumen of the appendix. Can you remember? So pain is vague, poor, around umbilicus, around epigastrium, sometimes it is referred to the chest, shoulder, these are the areas. Why? Because this pain is carried by the sympathetic fibers. Which sympathetic fibers? Just now I told? T5 to T12. They are the sympathetic fibers by which the abdominal visceral nociception is carried. So, in the appendicitis also, the nociception will be carried by these dermatomes. Now you can imagine, the same T5 fibers are also innervating hand. So, appendix pain can be referred in the hand as well. Same T5 fibers are innervating the thorax. So appendicitis pain can be referred in the thoracic areas as well. And because it is non-segmental, the localization will be poor. So one very important term we use, that the sympathetically mediated pain are poorly localized. They cannot point with the finger. Like if you ask them, what is your pain? Point with your finger? They can't. They might be moving the whole hand, you know, this is my area of the pain. But if it is a somatically mediated pain, they will be pointing with the finger that this is the area of the pain. They cannot draw the pain map easily. One, they will be drawing the India map, one Bangladesh map, one Pakistan map. Three different types of map they will be drawing. Because it is vague, it is poorly localized, and they cannot put a finger to say where the pain is coming. Okay?